So we have to be careful. We have to understand approval, where we get it, and who we give it to, because both of those things are very important. We give approval to people and things unknowingly that we shouldn't. And that's what I want to talk about today, approval. And to do that, we're going to start in Galatians chapter 1. We're starting a new book. We're talking about Dear Church. And Dear Church is just a series about letters that Paul writes to different churches. And so we started in Galatians. We're going to start in Galatians today and be here for at least 2 weeks. So let's look at what we can find about approval from Galatians. Galatians chapter 1, verse 1. This letter is from Paul, an apostle. I was not appointed by any group of people or any human authority, but by Jesus Christ himself and by God the Father who raised Jesus from the dead. Stop there for a minute. The first thing Paul is identifying here is his credentials. How many of you would be willing to go to a doctor that doesn't have credentials? He says, well, I just have life experience. Well, what is this medication going to do to me? Well, I don't know. I haven't actually given it to anybody, but a couple people told me that it causes diarrhea, upset stomach, and a headache. We wouldn't do that. We wouldn't go to a doctor who didn't have really any credentials, who wasn't educated. And there's something to be said about life experience. There is. But if with all of the medication out there, you don't want somebody who doesn't understand what the medication is going to do to you. And sometimes you watch these commercials. I don't watch commercials anymore because I really don't want to watch live TV. But if you ever see a commercial about medication they give you for migraines and then the side effects of those might cause diarrhea. Okay, headache, diarrhea. Well, headaches, it's a migraine. It's really bad. Okay, I can deal with that. Upset stomach. Well, usually diarrhea and upset stomach goes hand in hand. I can deal with that. Numbness of limbs. Okay, well, as long as not totally numb. And in some cases, death. It actually said that. In some cases, death. Well, I would rather be dead than have this migraine, so I'm just going to go ahead and take it. And sometimes we're just clueless when we go about things. Paul is telling them first and foremost of who he is. He is an apostle, but not just an apostle from man. He is apostle. He received his apostleship from Jesus Christ himself. This is something to be said. He wasn't by human authority, but by the Father who raised Jesus from the dead and Christ himself. In other words, what he's saying is, listen to me. I have something good to say. Now, if somebody was just to come up and say, hi, Jesus told me that I was an apostle and I need to tell you something, would you believe that person? Well, you know, yeah, maybe, maybe not. Paul's statement here wasn't a self-proclaimed statement. Everybody knew, not just because he said he had this vision from Jesus, but there were people with him who witnessed what happened to Paul. And then Paul was told to go meet somebody, and God spoke to that somebody and said, go find Paul. Oh, but Paul kills Christians. Oh, well, don't worry, I'm going to use him. And then, not only after that, he starts traveling for the sake of Jesus, suffering. You read the book of Acts, you find that he was almost killed more than once, all because of what Jesus had called him to do. So there wasn't any just Paul saying this, and so he has the authority. There were things that were backing this up. Then he says in verse 2, all the brothers and sisters here join me in sending this letter to the churches of Galatia. If you don't know Bible geography, we'll do a little bit of education here. Galatia is kind of the southern part of what is present-day Turkey. Actually, most of it, but... and it wasn't to a church, it was to several churches in that area. And so what Paul expected, and this happened to all of Paul's letters that we're aware of, and most of the other letters that we read in the New Testament, is that a church would receive a letter, and they would read it, and then they would pass it on to another church. And then that church would pass it on to another church. And sometimes they would actually get rewritten or copied so that there would be more than one copy. This was what happened with this letter along with a lot of other Paul's letters. Even though a lot of other Paul's, other like 1st and 2nd Corinthians, they were that those letters were specifically written to Corinth, to the people in Corinth, the churches in Corinth, but it was not limited to them. The same way that we learn from what is written in Corinthians or Galatians of this matter, all of the other churches could have the same benefit. So Paul is writing to churches in a specific area, and there's a very important reason he's writing this letter. But he continues in verse 3, "May God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ give you grace and peace. Jesus gave his life for our sins, just as God our Father planned in order to rescue us from this evil world in which we live. All glory to God forever and ever. Amen." I am, and this is where he just cuts to this. He says, this is all good stuff here. Okay? Jesus was raised from the dead. Everything is cool. The way the Father had planned, he has rescued us from this evil world. If you read the New King James and some other versions, it doesn't say this evil world. It says this present age. There's a lot of discussion about this present age. Some people believe that this present age is what is called the age of the Gentiles, in which Gentiles kind of ruled over Jerusalem, Israel, and that's kind of the understanding that some people have. Some people believe, as New Living Translation says, it's just the evil world in which we live. There's no particular proof that one is over another. I like the idea that the world in which we live before Jesus comes back, the age we are living in right now before Jesus comes back, and when it says that we will be rescued from it, he's not saying that we will be taken away from it. He's saying that we can receive the power to overcome it. Rescue isn't rescue as in removing, it's rescue as in giving you the power to stand strong in the presence of this age. And these should be good words for us, because we are living in an evil world. We are living in an evil world. Now, it might come to a surprise to you. Hopefully not. Hopefully you've listened to me long enough that this isn't going to be a new revelation to you. The world is any more evil now than it was 100, 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 years ago. It isn't. Back then, they would sacrifice babies to a foreign god. They would kill their babies. They would slaughter them on an altar to a foreign god. We do the same thing, called abortion, except for it's not to a foreign deity, it's to convenience. Oh, this baby is going to cause my life to be inconvenient, so let's make it go away. Evil, we live in an evil world. We always have, and we always will, until the day Jesus comes back. And what God is giving us, Paul is telling us that God is giving us the ability to live in this world righteously until he comes back. You guys ever remember that Calgon commercial? And the lady says, "Calgon, take me away." That's how some people believe, that's how some people feel about this world. Just take me away. Just take me away. The problem with that is that God has a purpose for you. If your desire is just to be gone from this world, you're missing out on a lot of blessing that God wants to give you. And it's not just a new car, a bigger home, money to do what you want. The blessing that God desires, and this has always been the blessing that God has for his people, isn't stuff. It's things that are eternal. God's blessing for you is for you to influence other people for his name, so that they can realize and understand and experience the love that Jesus has for them. And to say, "Jesus, take me away," is actually kind of selfish. It is. You're saying, "Forget about all you guys. I want to be with Jesus. You guys can just fend for yourself." Selfishness has no place in the kingdom of God. And so while we are going to be rescued as we live in this evil world that we reside in, it's not to be taken away. It's to stand firm, stand strong, and be obedient to God. He continues in verse 5, "All glory to God forever and ever. Amen." And then he gets to the real reason for the letter. Verse 6, "I am shocked that you are turning away so soon from God who called you to himself through the loving mercy of Christ. You are following a different way that pretends to be the good news, but is not the good news at all. You are being fooled by those who deliberately twist the truth concerning Christ." Have you ever, somebody ever come to you and says, "Hey, I have some really good news. This is awesome news. I have some really good news." And you're like, "Okay, give it to me." And they say, "I love you, man." "So? It's great that you love me, but how is that good news to me?" Good news is always about perspective. I said this before. The good news of the gospel is great news for people who are being saved. But people who are not being saved, it is actually a thorn in their flesh that is going to end in disaster. Now, it's good news that everybody can be saved. But unless you are saved, what good does it do you? It doesn't do you any good. When Paul's talking about good news, he's talking from a perspective that there is good news, but this good news has to be actual good news in the form that it was supposed to be translated in. So, what is the good news? Jesus came, he died for our sins, was resurrected, and is spending eternity in God. So, it gives us the opportunity to spend eternity with God. So, if that's the good news, what is he talking about here when he says that it is pretend to be good news? Well, the pretend to be good news is simply bad news. If good news is pretend, that only leaves one logical explanation. And that is that it's bad news. Have you ever been excited about bad news? If you do, I do counseling on Thursdays. I'm not that kind of counselor. We don't like bad news. But we can be deceived in thinking that bad news is good news. It's pretend good news. And Paul was dealing with that. This is why he wrote Galatians. He wrote Galatians because he was dealing with a good news that was not really good news. It was pretending to be good news. And we don't have time to go into a lot of it, but if you read Galatians chapter 3, Paul says a lot of things in chapter 3, but he says this about this false, this pretend good news. It is adding obedience to the law as a requirement for salvation. That's what he says. Adding obedience to the, adding obedience of the law as a requirement for salvation. Now, a lot of people will say that Galatians is about legalism. And I disagree. There's a lot you can learn and a lot you can understand about legalism and in Galatians, but it is not about legalism. It's about adding to the gospel. It's about you need something more than Jesus to be saved. And that's a dangerous thing. Because what more could we actually do to be saved? And the people who were preaching this pretend gospel, they were telling the Galatians that they had to accept Jesus through faith, and then they had to follow these laws to be saved. Here's a problem with that. And that is that puts a lot of pressure on us as human beings. How many laws do you have to break to be a bad person? Let's think the way God thinks for a minute. How many laws do you have to break to be a bad person? One. All it takes is one. We read that if you break one law, then you've broken the whole law. Because unlike our understanding of the law, we view the law as the Ten Commandments. Okay? And we think, well, you know, I haven't killed anybody. And so I didn't break that law. I haven't committed adultery. So I haven't broken that law. I honor my mom and my dad most of the time. So I haven't broken that law. Okay, I lied once when I was younger, so I must have broken that law. And we separate these laws and say, well, I didn't break this one. I might have broken this one, so I'm pretty good. I've kept 9 of them and broken 1 of them. I've kept 8 of them and I've only broken 2 of them. So I'm pretty good. That's not how God looks at it. You know what he never does? You never read that it is the laws of God. It is always the law. One. When you break it, you've broken the whole thing. There's no half breaking or partial breaking the law. You do it once and it's broken. And that is how God views it. And so when we say, when false apostles or people who are preaching a pretend gospel says you need Jesus and you need to follow the law to be saved, they are setting you up for failure because you can't do it. If you read what Jesus says about the many of the Ten Commandments, it's not even about what you do. It's about what you think. This is why Paul was addressing this issue. Because he didn't want them to think that their commitment to God or their salvation from God is based not just on faith in who Jesus is and what he has done, but also on their ability to follow the law. And it's in it, and while we don't, well, we all will sit here, and if you've been in church long enough, it's easy to say, well, we know that that's not true. We've been around, the Bible's been around long enough that we are smarter than that. We're 2,000 years removed from when this was written. We all know that you're not saved by your works. We know that it is about just complete faith. And yet, why do we convince people that they need to be living a certain way? Why is it that you don't go to church? I'll be praying for you that you go to church more often. You watch what movie? Isn't that rated R? You went where? You said what? What are all those? Expectations you have of other people? So he's dealing with something that we fight today, and that is adding things to the salvation that God gives to us. And we need to be very, very cautious that we don't do that, because there is a stern warning, and we're about to read it. I'm going to go back and read verse 7 and then finish through verse 10. It says, but is not the good news at all. You are being fooled by those who deliberately twist the truth concerning Christ. Let God's curse fall on anyone, including us or even angels from heaven, who preaches a different kind of good news than the one we preach to you. I say again that we have said this before. If anyone preaches any other good news than the one you welcome, let that person be cursed. These are strong words. Curse here is the same idea that we get from Deuteronomy chapter 7 when God says, cursed is he who breaks the law. Listen, I don't want to be cursed. Some people will say, well, curses aren't true anymore. You can't curse somebody. Well, do you believe in blessings? Oh, yeah, well, blessings, yeah, you can receive blessings. Well, why wouldn't you be able to receive a curse if you can receive blessings? So we get this idea how important it is to make sure that what we are teaching people is the true gospel, the true good news. Because if we are teaching people something other than that is truly good news, Paul says it's a curse. There are a couple of things that we need to realize, I think, that can help us in being who God has called us to be and living out what God has called us, a life that God has called us to do. Kind of the what we need to know if we want approval rating, a high approval rating. Okay? First and foremost, and this, it cannot be understated, and that is we need to understand that there is a false gospel. There is a false gospel. And some people are knowingly preaching a false gospel. And Paul says that this is what he's really dealing with. He says, verse 7, but it is not the good news at all. You are being fooled by those who deliberately twist the truth concerning Christ. They are deliberately telling people something that is false. But it doesn't say whether what their motives are behind it. Sometimes motive is more important than anything else. But I tell you this, I don't care what your motive is, breaking God's law is never acceptable. The ends never justify the means when it comes to breaking God's law. We need to understand that there is a false gospel going around. And it's not just about eternal salvation. Okay? The gospel is about being saved by faith because of Jesus' sacrifice and God raising him from the dead. That's the gospel. And while our differences in teaching and how we interpret the Bible might not ever remove the truth of the gospel, anytime we pervert the word of God, we are in danger of doing that, just that. And I'll take, for instance, my brother. I've mentioned this many times. Most of you know this. My brother's a practicing homosexual. And we've talked about it. He goes to church. He loves Jesus. He tells me that. The church that he attends, and I don't know how frequently he attends the church, but the church that he attends preaches that homosexuality is okay. There's a movement in churches about certain things being okay that the Bible says are not okay. And does this specifically affect a person's faith in Jesus and their ability to spend eternity in heaven? Does believing that homosexuality is okay determine a person's eternity? Personally, I don't think that your misunderstanding of part of Scripture determines your eternity. But what it does do is that it causes you to misunderstand one part of Scripture that will inevitably lead you to read the Bible how you want to read it. So you begin with homosexuality is okay. And maybe you move on to no abortion's no big deal. Oh, well, you know, the Ten Commandments, they're good. You know, honor your father and mother. Yeah, but guess what? God doesn't know my mom and dad, and they don't deserve honoring. Where does it stop? You start making up your own rules when it comes to following God. And once you start doing that, you are starting down the road of abandoning God altogether. And you don't even realize it. This is Satan's trick. Satan has never been one to come outright with humans, to come outright and destroy God in front of those who believe. Okay? So you take this church, Satan's not going to come in here and say, well, you guys are a bunch of idiots. God doesn't love you. He put you on his earth, and now you just got to live your life and enjoy it as much as you can. He's not going to do that because he understands how we think. Not because he can read our mind, but can he read our life. And he attacks us where we think. Satan knows he's not going to convince me that homosexuality is okay. So he's not going to attack me there. But if he can convince my brother, who was raised in the same Christian home I was raised in, if he can convince him that homosexuality is okay, then he can convince him that other things that the Bible says are wrong are okay. And it leads to a place where we abandon the God, the one true God, altogether. And a lot of times, the people who do that are clueless to it. And when they finally realize it, it's probably too late because then they don't really care. It's a slow fade. To overcome this, we need to understand that there is a false gospel, and that it doesn't lead us where we want to go. It might seem be okay. What does it really hurt if a person wants to be a homosexual? What does it really hurt? I've had people ask me that question. Why is it that bad? They're not hurting anybody at all. Why is it that bad? This brings us to our second thing that we need to understand is that there is a severity of the soft gospel that cannot be understated. I talked about Paul twice. He said there was going to be a curse on those teaching this. Why is it so bad when it doesn't seem like homosexuality? And I'm picking on homosexuality mainly because it's so close to home for me. But it could be anything. It could be anything. Anything the Bible says you are not to do, and then you do. It could be something as simple as lying. It could be something as simple as, I can't think of anything off the top of my head now. Gluttony. No, but is gluttony all that bad? Really? I mean, it doesn't hurt anybody except for the person who's a glutton. Pastor Steve, you know what? I'm a single guy. You know, sleeping with my girlfriend, why is that a bad thing? It's not hurting anybody. I'm not hurting anybody. We're going to get married anyway. So why is it that bad? It's that bad because we are compromising the Word of God. And if you're willing to compromise it once, you're giving Satan a foothold to compromise it more. There's a severity in this false gospel that we cannot allow to ruin not just our relationship, but everybody's relationship with God. Let's assume something happens, and I decide, I know this will never happen, so don't worry. I decide that, you know what, after reading and studying the Bible, I realize that God meant not to have sexual relations with people of the same sex. They meant that for 2,000 years ago. It does not apply today. And I've justified it in my mind. And while it might not deter me from a solid faith in Jesus, there's not a lot of people who would behave the same way if that's how they believed. My brother is a prime example. I was not going to talk about him today. I told myself, don't bring him into this because I was reading, because I love my brother, I have done a lot of research on how to talk with somebody who believes they are homosexual but still professes to be a Christian. And I've done a lot of research on this. And believe it or not, most of the people who who are homosexual do not believe in isolating their relationships to one partner for life. They believe that, many of them believe that you have one partner at a time, but most of them don't believe that you isolate and have one partner for an entire lifetime. Why does that surprise us? Most heterosexuals don't believe that. That's why divorce rate is so high. The problem is that it doesn't matter how strong you are. Once you allow a deception of God's word into your life, it will deter you and deter the people around you from the truth of God's word. And you won't even realize it. And that's why Paul gives it a curse, because what happens is you, if you follow that road, will inevitably lead you to abandoning your relationship with God altogether, unless something happens in your life that changes that. And you said, Pastor Steve, man, you're laying it on strong. Hell is real. Can't afford to be nice. I in the last 6 months, I've dealt with 4 different people, ranging from people who are sleeping together and not married, no big deal. People who think it's okay to cheat and lie to people to get what they want. And believe it or not, these people want to talk to me. I have no clue why. I don't know why. Because it's not like I'm saying, oh, you cheat and lie to people? Oh, well, that's good. God's going to bless you. Go for it. Be productive. It's like, well, why are you cheating and lying? You know where liars go? Where? Actually, my mom disagreed with that. Because every time I told a lie, I had to go up to my room. When we allow little things in our lives that misinterpret the word of God, what we end up doing is we remove the sacredness of God's word in our life, and then everything is questionable. Either all of the Bible is true or none of it is true, because it claims to be true. It's either all true or it's like that. We talked about the breaking of the law. You break it once, guess what? You broke the whole thing. And that's kind of like the God's word. If it's not all true, then none, you can't rely on any of it. And so to say, well, polygamy, no big deal. I can have more than one wife at a time. I don't know why any sane guy, would even remotely. If you are not going to believe everything in the Bible is true, you might as well not believe any of it. Because if you believe part of it's a lie, then all has got to be a lie. There's a severity to this false gospel we cannot underestimate. And so we have to be careful, not just what we believe, but who we listen to. Who we listen to is very important. Because there are people who will tell you part of the Bible is not. I was watching a video, and Facebook is really weird. Because they will throw up some really good videos for me to watch, and then they will throw up nonsense a video of some woman who thinks she's a cat. And so she's eating her food out of a cat dish. And here's the thing. The cat dish was only this big around. How in the world... I didn't watch that video. I just... Yeah. But I was... I was watching one video, and it was a pastor who was talking about God and saying that God's sex is malleable, which means it can change. So I want to ask, what sex did he begin with? I use the word he loosely there. Was God male and then turned female? And then turned back to male? Or was he... You know why this pastor is saying this? Because it supports an idea of the world we live in. We are making God in our image. We want humans to be able to change sexes whenever they want. I can become a girl, and then I can become a guy, and I can go back to being a girl, or I can go back to being a guy. But to do that, we have to, if we really want to believe in God, we have to say that God's able to do that too. Because if we can prove that God's able to do that, then it's okay for us to do it. We cannot underestimate the severity of this false gospel, whether being taught or teaching it. And this, what it all comes down to is the last thing that Paul says in the passage that we read. And I'll reread this. Verse 10. Obviously, I am not trying to win the approval of men, but of God. If pleasing people were my goal, I would not be Christ's servant. This pastor that I talked about, who said that God's sex was fluid, first of all, he completely is misunderstanding who God is, because God is spirit. And as a spirit, he does not have a body. And as that, he does not have a sex. And so he doesn't change sexes. Because he doesn't have a sex, because doesn't have a body. But one of the things that this pastor was doing is he's trying to get approval of people who want to say that you can change sex at will, because God does it, so you can do it. It was about approval. And in fact, most of what people teach that is contrary to the Bible is about approval rating. It's about approval rating. You want a big church? If you say the right thing and do the right thing without relying on the power of the Holy Spirit, you got to tickle people's ears. Paul talks about that in Timothy. Tickling people's ears. Listen, people love to hear what agrees with their philosophy of life. That's what tickling ears. My brother, hardcore Democrat, and actually he said this to me. I stopped talking politics with my brother because it ends up in fights, not fist fights. I could take him easy. arguments, verbal arguments, and he actually made the comment that Donald Trump was the devil's tool. Now, I am not here to promote Donald Trump, okay? So don't get me. But it shows a person is willing to say anything to justify their belief. Was Donald Trump a tool of Satan? Doesn't seem that way to me, but I don't know for sure. God has to ask God that one. We want to agree with things that align, and we want to hear things that align with our way of thinking. We could probably fill this sanctuary if we started promoting things that people in the community agreed with. Things like, well, if you start serving God, He's going to start giving you more finances in your life. Oh, don't worry about living a holy life. You just live the way you want to, and God will take care of you. Start saying things like that, and you'll be amazed at how people will start coming into your church. The problem is that now you have a church full of people who are going to hell. Approval rating is deceitful. Most of the time, because people really just are going to say what they think is right. And we have to ask ourselves two very important questions when it comes to approval. First, whose approval are you living for? Whose approval are you living for? And again, I don't want to say, I know if I was to ask each one of you, I know your response, what your response will be. Pretty simple. Well, I'm living my life for Jesus. I want His approval. How do you know? What in your life tells me, or anybody for that matter, what in your life tells us that you are living solely for the approval of God? Pastor Steve, I go to church. I don't go to church every Sunday, but I'm there 3 weeks out of the month. Oh, well, that's good. Oh, and I give to church too. That's good too. Oh, and I don't cuss either. Not very often anyway. Oh, and I love everybody. Except for my neighbor who lets his leaves blow in my yard. Yeah, that's still a sore subject with me. I love him. I'm getting there anyway. There's one thing that we need to focus on. And again, if we think that going to church 3 weeks out of the month is actually really getting us where we want to go, we are greatly deceived. If we think that giving 50% of our income away is going to get us where we want to go, we are greatly deceived. If you think that you crack open your Bible every day, it's going to get you where you want to go, you are greatly deceived. Now, I'm not telling you that these things are not good. And I'm not telling you that these things won't help you in your life. But there is only one thing that is truly going to help you in your relationship with Jesus, and it needs to be a foundational thing. And I haven't mentioned prayer yet, but this is not it either. You have to get your heart and your mind lined up with God's heart and God's mind. going to church, it's going to be good for you. In fact, the more you go to church, the better it'll be for you. The less you go to church, guess what? The less benefit you're going to get from it. Reading your Bible. The more you read your Bible, guess what? The more you're going to get, you're going to benefit from it. But to say that if I have to read my Bible so often to have a relationship with Jesus simply means that anybody who does not have a Bible cannot have a relationship with Jesus. Whose approval are we seeking? Whose approval? When we buy things, are we thinking about how it'll make us look good? When we do things, are we thinking about how it'll make us look good? Now, I'm not opposed to looking good, okay? I took a shower this morning, and I dressed kind of nice, although my wife already complained about what I was wearing, so. I hope all of you took a shower before you come to church. I want you to dress nice. But are you dressing for me? Are you dressing for your friends? Are you dressing for your spouse? Or are you dressing for God? Are you doing things to impress people? Are you doing things to impress God? Are you buying things to impress people? Are you buying things to impress God? I'm not saying that God doesn't want you to have nice things. Don't get that from this. But there comes a point where we have to ask ourselves, am I doing an approval for people or an approval for God? I'm going to close with one final thought. And this isn't in the scripture that we've read, but it's an idea that is very important. And it's not about whose approval we're seeking, but whose approval we're giving to others. Whose approval we're giving to others. And what I mean by that every decision we make has some type of approval toward other people. Okay? I don't know my brother's pastor or the church where he used to attend. I don't know where he's going now. I don't know that pastor at all. But I would not approve that pastor, because I believe he's distorting the word of God. But do I make decisions specifically for myself, no matter who or what it approves? I'll use an illustration. Music. Listen, I've said this before. I am a closet rocker. You know what that means, right? I go in my closet and I get in my rocking chair and I rock back and forth. No, that's not what that means. I like rock music. Not only rock music, but I like rap music. How many people think rock is of the devil? Well, hey, you guys are good. Listen, the devil doesn't own all the good music. But when we are listening to certain people who are not godly people, when we buy their music, when we listen to them around young ears, you know what we're doing? We're approving. Same thing with movies. Now, I'm not trying to be legalistic and say you can't listen to certain music and you can't watch certain movies, okay? That's not what I'm saying. What I am saying is you need to be careful who you're approving, especially in front of people, especially in front of kids. It took a whole new light when I had Eli. I even had to change the things I said. I can't use the word but in front of Eli anymore. You know why? Because every time I do, he says, "Daddy, that's a bad word." And he's right, I shouldn't be using that word. But that's just a short example of we have to, without being legalistic, we have to ask ourselves, who are we giving approval to? I cannot be your judge. I cannot be your judge on what you watch, what you listen to, what you read. I can't be your judge on where you go. Because as I said in the very beginning, when I started preaching this morning, I am not going to be standing next to you when you face Jesus. Your spouse, not going to be standing there. Your kids, not going to be standing there. Your boss, your neighbor, your best friend, not going to be standing there. So you have to ask yourself, what am I approving? Now, I'll clarify this. I don't believe in boycotting. And here's why I don't believe in boycotting. Because you never truly do. How many people know somebody at some point in time boycotted Target? You know somebody like that? Guess what? Chances are, guess where they're going to right now? Target. Doesn't last. You probably know somebody who's boycotted Disney probably 10 or 12 times by now because of something they did. Here's the problem with boycotting, is you're not solving the problem. You're being judgmental. You're saying, well, I think what they're doing is wrong, right or wrong, whatever they're doing, I think it's wrong. And so I think we all should boycott them. I have a better idea. Because people who boycott don't do this. Instead of boycotting Disney, why don't you pray for them? What? That's not how boycotting is supposed to work. I'm supposed to hate them. That's what boycotting is. You hate what they're doing, so you're going to boycott them, and you're going to talk bad about them. You want to change the world, stop boycotting and start praying for them. There are things that I won't watch. There are things that I won't listen to. There's people I won't support because of my convictions. But those are my convictions. You got to make your own. You got to live your own. But it's not about avoiding things. You never draw closer to God by avoiding sin. I'm going to repeat this because some of us misunderstand. You never draw closer to God by just avoiding sin. But when you draw closer to God, guess what you avoid? Sin. This is what I said. Our solution is not about doing this or not doing that, about avoiding these people, about hanging out with these people. Our solution is about getting our heart and our mind in line with the heart of God and the mind of God. That is going to be our solution. And that is going to be the way we live the life God wants us to live. So I'm going to close in prayer. And I want you to ask yourself, who have you been listening to that you need to stop listening to? Not because I said it. I specifically have not mentioned any names, any shows, because this is between you and God. What are some things that you've been doing that you need to stop doing? Some people you have been promoting that you need to stop promoting? And some choices you need to make differently to seek God's approval instead of man's approval. You're the only one who can make that. Let God speak to your heart. Let God speak to your mind. Let him speak to your soul and make these changes in your life. Heavenly Father, we love you. Still within me the worries of life. Here my heart is at peace. We love you because you first loved us. We don't want to just avoid sin. We want to draw close to you. Help us to align our minds through the reading of your scripture. Help us to align our minds with the mind of Christ. To live as he lived. Help us to align our hearts with your heart. To desire the things that you desire. To promote the things that you promote. To follow after the things that you follow after. Let this be a change that you make in our lives. Not for change's sake, but for holiness and righteousness. Let it be decisions that are made not to impress people, but to seek your approval, God. Help us to draw near to you. For it is when we are close to you that we live the way you want us to live. We thank you for this. We love you. We just ask that you go with us. In your name, amen. All right, guys. Love you. Be blessed. We'll see you on Wednesday.